Hey guys, I'm Scott Allen Miller. This is my life living in Latin America. And I got a question. I actually get this quite often. So I feel that this is important to address. So I'm just throwing my phone on the holder and we're going to go ahead and talk about this. And the question is about what will happen if the United States decides to start withholding Social Security checks from people that they no longer deem as someone that they want to pay their Social Security to. So let's talk about that right after the bump. This question came in today, but I get the same question very similarly pretty often. Please give me your thoughts on expats losing Social Security checks if living out of the country. This is obviously for Americans, for those who haven't picked up on that. Is it possible that President Trump puts that law into place? So let's start with a quick answer. No, there's no possibility whatsoever. Cannot happen, so don't worry about it. It is completely 100% implausible, and it is a scare tactic used by fearful Americans, or more appropriately, jealous Americans who are trying to browbeat people that they see as having potentially better lives than them from leveraging those advantages or leveraging their bravery to leave the country. And in some cases, it may be people who are fearful that your money or voice that they currently have control of, or in their minds have control of, will take that and exercise your freedoms. But basically the threat or the question here is, will my fundamental freedoms and property ownership as an American be taken away from me under Donald Trump? And while there are plenty of things for Americans to legitimately be afraid of, for sure, there are lots of things that could happen. I'm not saying that things are great. I'm not saying that you should be happy. I'm not saying you shouldn't, but we should be afraid of things within the realm of possibility and not allow people to make us feel scared with things that make no sense. And this helps you highlight when you're dealing with someone who either is not rational and just saying things, or doesn't take you seriously and thinks that they can just say anything to try to scare you. So let's talk about this from a practical perspective. So let's start actually with a really clear dive into the mind of Donald Trump. And if we're talking about something like this, we're talking about the actual president having to be involved. No one is going to casually take away Social Security checks. Of course, that would require the president. This is a thing that is unprecedented in America. And technically, I think most people would argue the president can't possibly have this power, but let's dig into that. So first of all, Donald Trump has made it so crystal clear, gone to such lengths to promote and talk about how much he loves expats. The government under Donald Trump has run on the pro-expat platform. And I know a lot of people didn't pay attention to this, and a lot of people think that you didn't pay attention to this, hence things like this being said. But every single thing that Trump said about expats has been consistent, that he loves expats and he is doing everything within his power to promote making expatting as valuable and powerful a tool for you to use as he can come up with, right? Within reason. Now, does that mean that he has been consistently lying and everything he ran under is going to be flipped once he comes into office? Okay, but it's not very plausible. He has lots of things that he said that he's flip-flop on. This is not one of them. So every aspect of the Trump presidency so far has been pro-expat, to base a fear around that he will completely change to the opposite of who he is. He's not a smart way to go. Could it happen? Sure, but meteors can take out the earth at any moment too. It's not likely to happen. You can't plan around it. Planning around something that goes against all of our evidence, we could literally say anything. What if they start executing people who become expats? What if they put them in spaceships and send them to Mars as punishment, right? We can come up with any ludicrous thing. That's kind of where we are. We're just coming up with a disconnected fear that is not founded on anything. Okay, that's the first part. So not only is it unfounded, but we have loads of evidence, both from his first term and from his running for this term, that this is the opposite of what Trump is going for, the opposite of how he tunes his government. And I have videos where we've talked about how strongly Trump's tax regime is designed to promote expatting, so that you are going to have a government that is looking to support this, not curtail this. Okay, then let's get into the practicality of this. What if the government was to try to take away Social Security from any group of people? Well, this is historically how countries run into uprisings. Pretty much any country anywhere in the world who's tried to take away their citizens' retirements from them ends up with armed insurrection. That is the standard the world over. Now, you may get a peaceful insurrection, a peaceful protest, and if that doesn't work, it turns into something a bit more serious, but pretty much any country that does this and does not back down on it loses their government. That's pretty much universal. So you don't do this without the expectation of no longer being the president, most likely not still being around, right? Like, this is the kind of thing that people flee for, or worse, right? So this is not something you do casually. This is something you do when you have lost your mind and you are looking for your entire government to be abolished. You would never do this if you had any expectation of continuing to govern, right? Seriously, this is a completely universally unsuccessful tactic to try to take, and basically no government would make that mistake. You have a lot of checks and balances on this, right? Even if Trump fully manages to become the dictator that he promised to many people that he would, and that's fine. People voted for that. If that's what they want, great. But he still unlikely would have the amount of power necessary to try to do something like this, even if he wanted to. Why would we think he wanted to when he's gone to such lengths to say he loves expats? Makes no sense, right? People who are saying this assume you know nothing about Trump and are just trying to use that you're afraid of him to use, and then they're just throwing things at the wall, right? Oh, here's a scary thing you've heard that he might do. So here's a thing that kind of seems related, right? And you'll be scared of that, right? He doesn't like immigrants, so we're going to pretend that this is somehow connected to that. How can he harm you? Maybe by taking away your Social Security, right? And they don't think through how disconnected, implausible, and not like Trump that that is, right? So it's just not very good from that perspective. But we have a slam dunk on this. We have an absolute this can't be done kind of problem. We actually have two slam dunks on this. So let's start with the second one, which I like to do. I always like to start with the minor point first. So the minor point, if this was to happen, which it can't, right? But let's just assume we went into the impossible universe. We went into Alice's Wonderland, and there is this, situation where they allowed the impossible to happen, and they've taken away your Social Security checks. Okay, so what would you do? Oh no, I moved away from the United States years ago, months ago, however, it doesn't matter, right? And in the time since then, I have saved more money. I'm in a better financial position than I was when I left. So now I have more power than I had before. This is the nature of moving away from a high-cost location. Then, oh no, I'm dependent on the Social Security check that is no longer going to arrive. What do I do? I would have to, simply move back. What's the alternative? Not moving away in the first place. So how bad is that situation? Of course, if you moved away on Thursday and on Friday this thing happened, you had to move straight back, that would be super unfortunate. But let's say you move away now and in 3 years it happens. Well, for 3 years, you can live with your Social Security, presumably, at much lower cost. You can save up money. You become a much more powerful financial person than you would be if you stayed in the United States. Obviously, you'd be living, potentially very well instead of starving and hoping to keep the lights on. Then this happens and the government says, oh, sorry, we're going to cut off your Social Security. Well, you would just move back to the United States and be in better position than if you hadn't left. So let's imagine the two yous, right? There's you who doesn't leave and you who does leave. You who does leave lives, let's say you're making $2,000 on Social Security, which is a good Social Security, right? So the one that moves to Nicaragua is living at $500 to $800 per month. And let's just say you're able to save $1,000 per month. You're literally gaining $1,000 of power, financial power, every month, and during that time living quite well. A single person living on $1,000 a month here in Nicaragua is not rich, but they're completely comfortable. I have viewers who are living far below that at like $800 a month and are perfectly happy, right? They own a house, they own a car, they're able to go out and do things, not wild things. They're not throwing money around, they're not making it rain, but they're living okay. At 25% more than that, your money's going to go pretty far. You're going to be just fine. So you do that for, let's say, those 3 years. So at 3 years, you're able to put away $36,000, hopefully into something like an index fund that's making you then residuals as well. So you've got money coming in from that on top of having $36,000 sitting in the bank. Then let's look at the other you, the you that stayed in the United States. You've been living there and getting your same $2,000 every month. You're living like a homeless person. At $2,000 a month, I don't know how you could possibly live anywhere in the United States. Someone is going to be able to pull that off, but it's going to be amazingly difficult, like truly epically hard. That person is not saving anything and is almost guaranteed to be completely depleting any savings that you used to have. Instead of adding $36,000 more to your savings, you probably have eaten away at some savings. So we'll just assume that you haven't and that you simply have not saved anything, but realistically, you will have lost a retirement position that you already had. Now, at the end of that 3 years, the government says, we're taking away Social Security for anyone who's living outside the country. The you that's already inside the country is going to laugh and say, ha ha ha, I showed you, I stayed behind, now I'm not losing my Social Security. The you that moved away says, I'm just going to move back. Now we're in the exact same position, except I have $36,000 more money than you do. I have 3 years of living better than you did, and I have amazing memories and ideas from it, and I learned a lot. This is an extreme situation that's never going to happen, and it shows why they will never do it. Because the last thing that the government wants is to recall diaspora who are not economically viable. You are literally not people from an economic perspective. I'm not saying that the government doesn't want Americans in the country, but as Americans who aren't working, you're actually a drain on the system. You are a financial liability to the country. They would up your Social Security to get you out of it if they could, right? Now, if you had a ton of retirement and you were living really well, yes, you are contributing very well to America, just like any other working person would be, and they want you here because, or want you there because you're adding to the economy. But if you're living on the edge and relying on your Social Security, you are not helping the American economy, and it's really important for the government if they're just looking at the money, looking at what's good for them, being completely non-altruistic, they are going to encourage you, find ways for you to retire outside the country. This is one of those things that people don't understand. When they're trying to make these claims and say, oh, this thing's going to happen to you, no, it's not. And the reason is because they're angry with you for leaving the country. No, they're not. You're doing what they want. You're doing both what they have stated flat out that they want, and you're doing what's logically good for the government. Now, is it good for you? Yeah, you happen to benefit too. And generally, even Donald Trump's government is not out to punish you for being happy. As long as you're doing what makes them happy, they're okay that you're happy, right? They're not absolutely irrational in this case. Like the degree to which we have to assume ludicrous behavior at every level of the government for this to even come up is pretty extreme. So we got to embrace that. But now let's talk about the big slam dunk. And this is huge. People do not understand how big this is. And we're going to play into a second part of this. The US government doesn't know if you're living outside the country. They can issue this threat all they want, try to define it, and supposedly they would, but it's going to be super difficult. Do you take every person who goes on vacation and say they don't get Social Security anymore? You're going to get a lot of unhappy people, basically the entire population, and again, uprisings and, you know, fire and brimstone and all kinds of problems. That's not going to go over very well. So you're going to have to come up with some kind of definition by which you say this person doesn't live in the United States. And I know a lot of you are going to jump in with, I got a simple definition. This isn't hard. You're wrong. You don't have a real definition that anybody can work with. It is hard. Point blank. There's no way around it. That's why every agency in the government either doesn't recognize the concept of living abroad, or the IRS has this super complicated, or not really complicated, but super hard one that requires you to be out of the country essentially all of the time. And then they give you all kinds of advantages to doing that, not disadvantages. They don't use that to punish you. So both historically, the government has done anything it can to encourage this, and the government that's incoming has gone out of its way to say it's going to and loves to encourage this even more than the other governments that the US has had. And that's what we expect going forward. Why would that change? There's no reason for that to change. The consistency is unbelievable. But it doesn't change the fact that No one can define what it means to live outside the country. Oh, you've been traveling for a year. You live outside the country. Well, I'm outside the country. That we can prove. We can look at my passport and see when I'm outside the country. But how do you define living outside the country? And when you become an expat, when you spend your time living outside the country, you learn pretty quickly that the idea that you are resident somewhere becomes a very fungible thing. So having been outside the US for about a decade, the US considers me to have been inside the US for about a decade, and I'm still a resident of Texas. So am I part of Texas, but not part of the US? Am I part of the US? Am I part of? It's a very, very difficult thing to define, and everybody's individual situation will be different. But it doesn't really matter what way we argue it. This is something that all governments struggle with, and the idea that someone lives in or outside the United States generally is impossible to define. I say kind of generally and impossible. It's generally so incredibly hard to define that it might as well be impossible. And there's so many things that would cause this to fall apart, such as, oh, you have dual citizenship and you needed to visit family, or you got sick somewhere, or you're on vacation and got stranded, or, you know, you could just come up with so many scenarios that would potentially cause people who were living in the United States to then lose their Social Security. And then suddenly you'd have people starving in the streets and becoming homeless, all kinds of major problems because something they barely controlled or did not control at all caused them to be considered living outside of the place that is their only residence. Lots of weird things would happen. And so I know that when you have not yet become an expat, it's very easy to imagine that there's this really simple, like you get on this plane and you check a box, I'm today an expat, and that's how it is. But that is not at all how it is. Expat is a lifetime behavior that you kind of determine between the idea of intent. You can say, I'm an expat. I can say, I'm an expat. What makes you an expat? I intended to leave the United States. I'm not on vacation. I intended to leave the United States. But from the United States perspective, I'm legally on vacation. So from my perspective, yeah, I'm an expat. But to the United States, I'm not. To the United States, I'm not living outside the country. To the United States, I am on a long vacation on which I am working. So they would have to create entire frameworks to be able to come up with a way to even discuss having a law like this. So people do not understand until they become an expat just how implausible anything that is tied to you'll be punished or this will happen to you if you live outside the country. Once you do, you'll say, oh, now I see what Scott's talking about. Of course they can't do this. There is just no way to make it happen. Now, let's go and look at the IRS rules, because this is interesting as well as an additional piece. And this is why I said there's a part two to our first part of this thing. So with the IRS rules, currently there is a way that you can get this massive tax benefit by living outside of the country and verifying that you live outside the country by being claimed by other countries. We have videos that go into this. Look for the foreign earned income exclusion because that will deep dive into that for you with some old videos, and it'll really clear that up, and I'll show you where all the laws are written and stuff. Those are what Trump's talking about, expanding, not contracting, because he loves expats so much. So as you do this, right, now basically it's when you become an immigrant in another country. It's not 100%, but basically. So when you become an immigrant or you are fully outside the United States for what qualifies for that rule, you get this massive tax advantage. In theory, there could be a tie-in with Social Security to say that you don't get Social Security if you're getting this tax advantage. It's completely implausible, but it is physically possible to use that rule and tie it to that. It does not change all the reasons that you can't do this. And we have one other really big reason to discuss yet, so don't leave. But if they were to tie those together, it brings in another problem. And that is that by and large, there's exceptions, but by and large, if you are receiving Social Security, you are probably retired. The foreign earned income exclusion only applies to foreign earned income, which means you're not retired. So people who are actively working and pulling a salary will get this income exclusion. Normally, those people opt not to take their Social Security. At some point, there are overlaps. If we're making a Venn diagram of people who are working and people who take Social Security, there is a sliver where they overlap, but it's a very, very small amount. And those who would look at this and simply maneuver small things like, oh, take my Social Security a little bit later, maybe retire a few months earlier, are going to solve a lot of this, or just accept a little bit of taxes so that they still get their Social Security. Generally, you wouldn't do that. You want the tax advantage. But when you do this, right, you're coming up, you have this tax advantage, and you decide to take your Social Security, all you have to do is step into the United States for a couple days, or do some international travel, or not claim your exclusion and you become a tax resident of the United States again. So you can opt at any moment without changing where you actually live to be seen by the IRS as being in the United States. And so if you're not taking that exclusion on a salary and want to pull Social Security instead, voila, it's something you're allowed to do any day you want. You don't have to wait. You don't have to do anything. It's an instantaneous thing that you always have the right to do as an American. And so you would simply say, okay, I need this tax advantage because I'm getting a salary. My salary is done. I would like to start my Social Security. Now I'm a U.S. resident as far as the U.S. is concerned, and you are no longer legally an expat in any sense to the United States, and you can receive your Social Security check. The thing that people are using as a scare tactic to try to make this feel plausible is they're saying that the U.S. may not send your Social Security check overseas. Well, that's very easy. Don't have it sent overseas. That is a false problem. I don't know anyone who gets Social Security overseas. You can. The U.S. completely allows that. They have never questioned it whatsoever. But especially when we're talking about Nicaragua, which in this particular question was tied to a Nicaragua video, but what if we're talking about somewhere else? You generally are not going to use local banking and local anything. It just doesn't make any sense. Even if you're living here full time, I know if you, again, if you are not an expat yet, all these things seem like, but wouldn't you do that? No, you would not. Not under normal circumstances, at least not here. There are cases where you would. These are not them, right? Could they potentially say we're not going to send Social Security checks somewhere else? I'm going to still say this borders on completely implausible, but it's got a sliver of okay, I'll accept that it's that someone thought of it isn't completely crazy, but it's not going to happen. Not going to happen. But it is much more plausible than not giving you Social Security. But it also is meaningless. If you're an American and you need to get Social Security, just have a bank in the US, get your money, and then send the money after you've cashed the check. This is a false problem that people who are not expats imagine you have to do this international banking stuff that's completely false, and that it's much more complicated than it is. You can make it complicated if you want, but for most of us, it is not. So that's another part of how would the US know that you're not living in the US? Your check is going to a US address, it's being cashed in the US, it's going into a US bank. Voila. Okay, now the final part. Why does all this become such a big deal when we're talking about Social Security, and why do people get so mad? Why is Social Security guarantee an armed uprising in every situation? Guarantee. Because Social Security is not a tax advantage. It is not paid for by society. It is your money that was taken from you by force, by the government, as a tax, put into an account. It is your money in your account. It is a retirement account. Yes, it's managed by the government. It is there to make sure that you don't become dependent on the government when you get to your older years. They want to give you this fallback, so they forcibly take your money but hold it for you. And I understand they use some, they replenish it. They're a little bit fungible on that. But it is your money. It is no different than if they seized your bank account, seized your house, or anything else. That is your cash being taken from you. And as we know, Americans are pretty adamant about people not stealing from them. And we have pretty strong beliefs that if people are actively invading our house, stealing our car, attacking us, that we should pick up arms and defend ourselves and our property. So because of this, and I'm not saying that's a bad thing, in this case, it's a really good thing because we need to do that stuff. If you're not willing to defend yourself, you're going to lose everything eventually, especially as a society. So in this particular case, that mentality is really powerful and much stronger than most countries. And most countries, it's pretty strong. So if the government comes in and is basically an armed robber stealing your accounts, you better believe that a lot of Americans feel that they can pick up their weapons and do something about it, especially when a large number of them are retirees who are looking at starvation and have nothing to lose. You're putting people on the street and making them homeless, but they do have access to guns and nothing to lose. Boy, that sounds like a recipe for disaster. Again, it's their money, and everyone else will jump on with them because you're stealing their money. Once you're willing to steal that money, literally, you would just take anyone's house. There is nothing that is sacred once you are stealing retirees' own bank accounts, right? This is the worst of the worst, stealing from those who are in the most desperate position. And most Americans would be also really upset about the fact that suddenly a bunch of people who had earned money and were able to take care of themselves were now dependent on the state, and now they had to be taken care of by their communities. Those people will feel that they are being stolen from as well. Now they feel obligated to give to someone because the government stole from them. this adds up to problems really fast. And all of it comes together to say it is logistically, it is ethically, it is logically completely impossible that the government would ever consider doing this. And trust me, they have never considered doing this. It is not something that has been kicked around. Even I understand that we truly believe there are some really dumb people in Washington. And it's true. There are some really serious dolts in Washington. But even those people aren't kicking around ideas like this. One or two. But no one that anyone takes seriously. No one that anyone listens to. Not a thing. So next time somebody tries to make you feel scared because they are jealous that you're looking at doing something that they don't feel brave enough to do, remember that one, they're jealous, and two, they're not respecting you enough to come up with a plausible lie. They're not even putting in the effort. There's reasons to potentially not leave the United States, for sure. This is not one of them. And so call them out on it. Don't let them just lie to you. Don't let them just make things up. And don't let them act out of jealousy and try to scare you into ruining your life and not taking advantages that you have as an American. Being an expat is one of the most powerful expressions of Americanism that you have the right to. Your American passport is fought for hard by the United States government to be one of the most powerful in the world. Very few passports give you more power than the American passport, and that's there for a reason. When someone comes and tries to scare you from exercising your rights, from exercising your freedoms, and specifically your American freedoms, that's very anti-American. Maybe you should remind them of that, that behaving like they're not American is not a great way to try to scare you into staying in America. It's a weird combination of things that they basically are saying they hate America and they don't like freedoms and the power that the American passport has. Yet you should not leave America because it's, I don't know, scary out there. It's a very, very weird tact for them to take. So share this video with them and let them know how implausible something like this actually is. Thanks for joining me. Like and subscribe. If you'd like to help support the channel, we got that link above. You can buy me a coffee at buymeacoffee.com/Scott Allen Miller. As always, you can join our membership. Hit that like. Tell someone else about the video, watch another video that helps a lot, and I will see all of you tomorrow.